The Bible says that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not counting our sins against us. He made Christ, who knew no sin, to be sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Jesus Christ, both God and man, died, was buried, and rose again. He died for our sins upon that tree, and rose again for you and me. If we believe that gospel true, eternal life he'll give to you. Seasons come and go, they don't stay. Before you know, tomorrow's yesterday. We walk through life as though it will not end, but just remember Christ will come again. The gospel of Christ, I'm not ashamed, for it's the power of God to save, by grace through faith, and faith alone. Only believe and heaven's your own. Believe today, please don't wait, for tomorrow could be too late. By grace through faith, faith alone, only believe and heaven's your own. A simple faith in the gospel. It's the power of God unto salvation.
Amen. I X'd out the wrong thing. Okay, so that's Larry Tidwell. He's from Birmingham, Alabama, and if you'd be interested in getting that CD, this is his email. I know it's kind of small, sorry. LarryTidwell@me.com. Okay, and you can email him, and he'll give you the instructions on how to get it. Now, I play this in my car all the time. The CD is a great CD. He's got, you know, The Anchor Holds, I Believe. It's got some great songs on it. I want to read you the inside of his, this is the thing it comes in. I want to read you what he says. He says, because this is called the Elvis Collection, the Elvis Gospel Collection. But this is what he says. Elvis was a great, gifted entertainer and still has a tremendous following. But the king that is alive that I'm talking about is the Lord Jesus Christ. If you have never trusted in the Lord Jesus Christ, you can do it today. The Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Romans 3:23. Therefore, we need a Savior. Romans 1:16, Paul wrote, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8 and 9, he said, "For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." 1 Corinthians 15:3-4, Paul states the gospel. "For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the Scriptures. By believing that he did that for you and receiving it as a gift by faith, you too can have eternal life." In your own words, you can thank God the Father for saving you by grace through faith in the gospel of his dear Son. I hope this album brings comfort and joy to you and your loved ones. May Jesus Christ be glorified through these songs. And so that's the heart attitude behind the man who is offering this album. And obviously, he has an unbelievably incredible voice. Okay? I absolutely love, I play this in my car all the time. And I'll tell you, sometimes, I mean, it just raptures you to heaven. No, he's not on iTunes. No, you have to get it via CD. And again, the email is Larry Tidwell, T-I-D-W-E-L-L, at M-E-M-E.com. So please contact him. Get this. I promise you, you will not regret having these songs to play. And just bless your heart. Okay? Find Romans chapter 9. Put something in Acts chapter 7. And also 2 Peter chapter 2. As we begin this week, Romans chapter 9, I want to make several observations concerning Romans chapter 9, 10, and 11. So Romans 9, Acts chapter 7, 2 Peter chapter 2. So we'll make several observations before we actually get into the exposition of these chapters. The first observation that we must keep in mind as we go through Romans 9, 10, and 11 is that these chapters are parenthetical in the book of Romans. In the same way that Romans chapter 6 and 7 are parenthetical, chapters 9 through 11 are parenthetical also. You remember how we were able to take the last verses of chapter 5 and merge them perfectly into the first verses of chapter 8 and show that they're one continuous thought if we were to remove chapters 6 and 7. Remember that? Because chapters 6 and 7 served a specific purpose in the book of Romans. They answered objections that Paul received, and he answered those objections. I'm not going to go through that again. I've done that enough times. But the same things happen at the end of chapter 8, the last verses of chapter 8, after Paul shares with us the fine print in the contract that God made with us that we looked at last week, and that settles the issue once and for all about the salvation that you have in Jesus Christ, and that nothing can separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And then at the end of chapter 8, verse 39, there's a parenthesis. And he covers why in Romans 9 through 11, why Israel fell. But then in chapter 12 and verse 1, he picks up right where he left off at chapter 8, verse 39. And we'll just look at that. Notice Romans 8 up on the board. I got it here if you're... But you should have your Bibles open. But Romans 8, 38, "For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus." And now chapter 12 basically says, in light of this incredible truth of the salvation that you have in Jesus Christ, he says, "I beseech you therefore," you know, in light of what I've just been talking about, "I beseech you therefore, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable servant. And then he continues in chapter 12 with doctrine that is specifically laser targeted to the body of Christ. So that's important to keep in mind. These are parenthetical and they deal with an issue separate than what he's been dealing about of the salvation that we have in Jesus Christ. Chapter 12 and on are the outworking of the doctrines that we received in Romans 5, 6, 7, and 8. Okay. Another observation that we'll make is this. If ever there were chapters in the Word of God where a preacher could run rabbit trails forever, it would be here. These chapters mention Israel, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Esau, Rebekah, Moses, Pharaoh. I mean, if a preacher wants to wax eloquent on all of the historical events that surround each of these biblical characters, literally you can stay in these chapters for a couple years. Easy. Because you're basically covering from Genesis to Deuteronomy. If you do that. Okay, now, that certainly is the prerogative of each and every individual person who looks at these chapters if they want to do that. It's the choice of every preacher who preaches these from these chapters, okay? I mean, let's face it, Abraham and Moses and Pharaoh and these guys are all fine in these chapters here. I personally do not want to study the character of every single of these individuals in these chapters and give all of the details of their lives and their history and the covenants that are associated with them, you know, the Abrahamic covenant, the Mosaic covenant, the Palestinian covenant, the Davidic covenant. Because you can do that in these chapters. You can do that in just in Romans chapter 9. You can cover all those things in detail. I don't want to do that for this reason. I don't believe that's what Paul is doing. I don't believe that's why they're mentioned there, so that you could look at all the historical data that surrounds these people and these personages. Although these people are mentioned in these chapters, this chapter is not about them. This chapter, especially Romans 9 and 10 and 11, these chapters are about God. They're about what God is doing. These chapters are about the omnipotence of God and the omniscience of God. These chapters present God as the God who looks into the future and makes decisions based on what he knows is going to happen. Like, for example, we'll look at some things briefly, not today, but as we go. Like, when Abraham had got Ishmael, and he got Isaac, Abraham prayed to God, "Oh God, that Ishmael would live forever before you," or whatever, and have this preeminent place before you. That was Abraham's prayer. Well, what did Abraham know? God looked down in the future and saw what the lineage of Ishmael would be. Ishmael is the father of Isis. See what I'm saying? This is not about them. This is about the omniscience of God looking forward and seeing, and God making decisions back then based on what would happen in the future. This is what's happening in these chapters. This is about the omnipotence of God. When Pharaoh resisted God's will, God said, "Oh, really? You little runt." And God demonstrated his omnipotent power in Pharaoh. I don't need to go into all the reasons about God hardening and Pharaoh's hardening and... That's not really about that. Although that happened, the chapter is not really about that. The main theme and the heartbeat and the thrust of these chapters is God Himself. And that's what we're going to look at. That's what we're going to understand. Now, the backdrop of this chapter, the canvas upon which these words are written, is that Israel has been temporarily set aside. Their prophetic program has temporarily been postponed. And naturally, those who've been set aside have some objections to this. They have some questions about this. Needless to say, they're upset. They're upset that God has turned from them and turned to the Gentiles and has left Israel holding the proverbial bag empty, and the Gentiles are running away with the contents, and they're out there presenting the good news to this world that salvation is available to all men, and all of that is happening apart from the instrumentality of Israel themselves. They're not happy about this, because it was going to be through the rise of Israel that God was going to bless the nations of the world. But now there's a message of hope and of mercy and of grace that is going out to the Gentiles, and Israel is not a part of that, and boy, are they peeved. They're upset. So Paul is going to take this opportunity through various events that took place in time past to explain to those who have fallen, to tell them why God is doing what he did and why he did it. But he's also going to say, God doesn't have to explain this to you anyway. Another observation that is interesting, to say the least, is that at the end of chapter 8, from verse 31 to the end of chapter 8, verse 39, which we looked at last week, we looked at the fine print in the contract that God has made with us. That in his fine print, he has not taken away anything that he gave us in the large print. Remember that? As we talked about last week, and how that all those who have trusted Jesus Christ to save them, and talked about the absolute, certain, and final and eternal salvation that we have, to the point where the apostle said that I am persuaded that neither death nor life shall separate us from the love of Christ. I mean, those are great and incredible promises that are made to the body of Christ. That's what we talked about. And then all of a sudden, you arrive at chapter 9. And you find people who likewise had been given great and precious promises. But now it seems as though God has changed his mind about his people who he foreknew. The promises that he made are not coming to pass. And this goes beyond their ability to understand and comprehend. And it would go beyond our ability to understand and comprehend if we did not know that this is a temporary issue for Israel. You see, when we talk about subjects like we're going to talk about now, I believe it's important to let everybody know that we are not anti-Semitic. We don't hate Jews. We don't hate the Jewish nation. We don't hate Israel. I mean, what we're going to talk about are biblical facts that are in the Word of God, that are reality in the world that we live in right now. You know, I mean, in these chapters, we will see how God dealt with Israel in the past. We'll understand a little better about the past. We'll see how God is dealing with them in the present. And we'll also see how God is going to deal with them in the future. All those things are there for us to look at in Romans 9, 10, and 11. But again, I say that these chapters are about God more than anything else. When looking at the past, we see the omniscience of God and the omnipotence of God. We see the all-knowing attributes of God in full display. We see his powerful attributes in full display. When looking at the present, we see the salvation of God. Yes, Israel's program has been postponed, but salvation is open to them anyway, just as it is to all other people in the world. Okay? Because there's no difference today between Jews and Gentiles. Now, this is a concept that even to this day is extremely difficult, if not impossible, for them to believe. See, they always thought themselves to be superior to the Gentiles, and in a sense, they almost had a right to believe that. I mean, God had separated them from the Gentile nations unto himself and had given them these great and precious promises. But now, to be on the same footing and the ground being level at the foot of the cross, this is very difficult for the Jew. This is difficult for him to grasp. It's not an idea that a Jew holds dear to his heart. He still believes he's the apple of God's eye. The fact of the matter is, he's not. Not for the time being. I mean, will God resume his program with them? If God did not, that would mean God is a liar. So, these chapters will make it clear that God is not done with Israel. He's not done with them forever. This is a temporary situation for them. All right. Another observation that will be of paramount importance as we enter into the study of these three chapters is this. We must always keep in mind, and we must always keep in view, what are the prevailing conditions when these words are written? What is going on at the time of this writing? If you lose that, you lose the canvas upon which this was written, and you lose the picture of which God is trying to paint. What was going on? Even what happened just a few years before the book of Romans was written. You can translate what I'm saying into three words. Context, context, context. If you leave the context of these words, you lose the meaning of what these words represent. So, boy, I'll tell you, I'm going to keep you in the context. You are staying in the context. Because the minute you deviate from the context, you end up with doctrines that are not even being taught here. Okay? And let me tell you, I have a lot of preacher friends, and there's a lot of ideas about these chapters that I don't see there. I don't even see them, but they see them, and they preach on them, and we're going to look at that. I'm personally not going to, so-and-so said this, and so-and-so said that. I'm not going to do, I'm going to share with you what I see in these chapters, period. Okay, and what I see, that's what I see, okay? And I will try to support everything I show you by the simplicity of the Word of God, by comparing spiritual things with spiritual things, the way we're supposed to do when we study the Word of God. Okay? Don't have any confidence in the flesh. Not my flesh or anybody else's. Believe the Word of God, okay? Because in order to fully appreciate these three chapters, you have to understand who the players are. Who's being spoken of here? What does the apostle mean when he quotes a verse like this? As he saith also in Osi. Osi is Hosea. That's the Greek way of saying the Hebrew name Hosea. Okay? Osi. I will call them my people, which were not my people, and her beloved, which was not beloved. Now, when you read a verse like this, which were not my people, what comes to your mind? Gentile. That's what comes to your mind, right? What about Romans 10:19? But I say, did not Israel know? First Moses saith, I will provoke you to jealousy by them that are no people, and by a foolish nation I will anger you. What comes to your mind when you see those words, by them that are no people? Huh? Everybody? Okay. Now I'm going to ask you to be true to the Word of God and let the Bible interpret itself. Because we have an exhortation from the author of the Word of God himself, the Holy Spirit, to compare spiritual things with spiritual things. The King James Bible is the only Bible on the planet that has its own built-in dictionary, and it's the only Bible on the planet that interprets itself. It's the only one. It's the only Bible on the planet that tells you how to study it. The only one. The NIV doesn't tell you how to study this book. The NIV doesn't tell you to rightly divide the word of truth. The New American Standard and the New King James and the Amplified Bible and the Moffat's translation and the Phillips translation and they don't tell you how to do it. The writings of Socrates don't tell you how to study the writings of Socrates. The writings of Plato don't tell you how to study the writings of Plato. Peanuts doesn't tell you how to study Peanuts. That's a cartoon character, by the way. There's only one book in the universe that tells you how to study it. And it's called the King James Bible. The divinely inspired word of God. And he tells you, study to show thyself approved, rightly dividing the word of truth. You see what happens when people disobey 2 Timothy 2:15? You end up with over 217 individual denominations in the United States alone. Each of them has a verse of scripture to justify their existence. Many of them have different ways that you can get to heaven, different ways of salvation. All of this confusion exists because people don't listen to the only verse in the Word of God that tells them to study the Word of God. Oops, sorry. So I want you to see who these people are that are no people. Because every one of you, just like many people, think it's the Gentiles. Oh, Don says, I don't think that. Yeah, because he knows what's coming. Huh? Turn with me to 1 Peter. And as you are turning there, do you remember who Peter is speaking to? Who? What does he call them? Who said that? Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia. Now remember the people that Peter is writing to. believe that Jesus Christ is their Messiah. So they had to be scattered sometimes after the cross. Not the scattering that Leviticus spoke of in the fifth course of punishment. This is a scattering that happened after the cross, and it happened at a specific place in time. Anybody remember where that was? Huh? That's pretty close. That's close. Thank you very much. And they stoned Stephen. Acts chapter 7. I mean, you don't have to turn there. I'll put all these verses here right now. I want to grab the context, okay? Stephen has been preaching to the rulers of Israel, trying to get them to repent of the murder of their king. And they stoned Stephen, calling upon God, saying, "Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." And he kneeled down and cried with a loud voice, "Lord, lay not this sin to their charge." And when he had said this, he fell asleep. He fell asleep. And Saul was consenting unto his death. And at that time, there was a great persecution against the church, which was at Jerusalem. Now, this is not the body of Christ. This is the church which was at Jerusalem. That's the kingdom church, made up of people who believed that Jesus Christ was their Messiah. And they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. The apostles stayed in Jerusalem, but the rest went. And devout men carried Stephen to his burial and made great lamentation over him. As for Saul, he made havoc of the church, entering into every house and hailing men and women, committed them to prison. Let me tell you, Saul had a lot of authority in Israel. This man was a Pharisee of the Pharisees. Don't forget that. And when he consented, he wasn't just like, say, "Oh, yeah, I'm agreeing with you." He gave the order to do it. And why did he do that? Because Saul knew that these people who believed that Jesus Christ was the Messiah, that imposter, he knew that what they believed could not coexist with Judaism in the world. He knew that. If there was one thing Saul of Tarsus was certain of, is that Judaism was not going away. We've been doing this for 1,500 years, 2,000 years. And if there's another thing Saul of Tarsus was certain of, it's that he would never be a Christian. Let's face it. What we have was handed down to us from Moses, confirmed to us by God with signs and wonders and diverse miracles of the Holy Ghost. Throughout history, God has been for us and always moved in our behalf. In his thinking, these people needed to be stopped before this Jesus thing got out of hand. When he stood before King Agrippa, Paul said, "I verily thought within myself that I ought to do many things contrary to the name of Jesus of Nazareth." Which thing I also did in Jerusalem. And many of the saints did I shut up in prison, having received authority from the chief priests. And when they were put to death, I gave my voice against them. And I punished them oft in every synagogue and compelled them to blaspheme. And being exceedingly mad
against them. I persecuted them, even unto strange cities. He wasn't just angry. He was exceedingly mad. He was out of his mind with fury. And he had a lot of pull and a lot of power in Israel to do what he was doing. So when they knew, when these people knew that Saul of Tarsus, the Pharisee of the Pharisees, circumcised the eighth day, of the tribe of Benjamin, zealous of the law, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, when they knew and found out that he was after them, you know what they did? They got out of Dodge. And you know what it says in verse 4, chapter 8, 4? Therefore, they that were scattered abroad, this is upon the stoning of Stephen, went everywhere preaching the word. So, those who believed that Jesus Christ was their Messiah, they're known as kingdom saints. Why are they called kingdom saints? You remember in Matthew chapter 16, Jesus Christ is having this conversation with Peter. And Jesus Christ said, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against them. And then the next verse says, I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom. That's why we call them kingdom saints. Because in Acts chapter 1, when they were gathered in the upper room, that was the group of people that Jesus Christ had said the gates of hell shall not prevail against them. That church, that group of people. In Acts chapter 7, upon the stoning of Stephen, they thought they were going into the kingdom. That was the next event on the stage of prophetic history. That was the next thing to happen. They thought they were going into the kingdom that had been prepared for them from the foundation of the world. There's another name these people go by. What is it? That's right, the little flock. It was the little flock that were scattered abroad and went everywhere preaching the word. Now, here's an important question. Who were they preaching to? How do you know that? Well, that's where they were sent. I'll tell you why. Acts chapter 11, verse 19. Now they which were scattered abroad upon the persecution that arose about Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, preaching the word to none, but unto the Jews only. Now why would they go to the Jews only? Because they were told, don't go to the Gentiles. Go not into the way of the Gentiles, and into any city of the Samaritans enter ye not. Remember that? The point I'm making is this. It is these people that Peter is writing to. These people who do not belong to the body of Christ here, in the, where they're at right there, because the body of Christ did not exist in Acts chapter 8. The body of Christ began with Saul of Tarsus, the first member of the body of Christ. Okay? These are the people that are scattered that Peter is speaking to. Now I want you to see what Peter tells them, and what Peter calls them, and what Peter says about them. Those people, the little flock. Okay? 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 1. Wherefore, laying aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisies and envies and all evil speakings, as newborn babes desire the sincere milk of the word, that ye may grow thereby. If so be, ye have tasted that the Lord is gracious, to whom coming, as unto a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious, Ye also, as lively stones, are built up a spiritual house and holy priesthood. You know you're not a priesthood, right? Body of Christ, you're not a priesthood. Okay. To offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Wherefore also it is contained in the scripture, Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Unto you, therefore, which believe, he is precious. But unto them which be disobedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, which they rejected, the same is made the head of the corner, and a stone of stumbling, and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word, being disobedient, whereunto also they were appointed. But ye, now that's talking about Israel, the nation of Israel, which rejected him. They stumbled at the stumbling stone, okay? But ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, and holy nation, a peculiar people, that ye should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light, which in time past were not a people, but are now the people of God, which had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Who were not a people of God? The Gentiles? Or the little flock? The little flock. I showed you this because I want you to be true to the Word of God, not true to a man-made theological system of interpretation. I want you to be true to the Word of God. Look back at Romans chapter 10, verse 19. But I say, did not Israel know? First Moses saith, I will provoke you to jealousy by them that are no people, and by a foolish nation I will anger you. Peter says that the little flock were not a people. Paul says it this way, by them that are no people. Those who were not a people are not the Gentiles. They were the little flock, and in the prevailing conditions that lie before us, and in the context of what Paul is speaking about, as we'll see as we go develop this more next week and on, the little flock are the players in Romans 9, 10, and 11. And if you don't see that, then I can't help you. See, notice these people who are no people, or who are not a people, are also called a foolish nation. You see that? A foolish nation, by a foolish nation, singular, not plural. Is that important? Is the little s important in the Word of God? The Gentiles are not a nation. The Gentiles are nations. Always. Always. There's no such thing as a Gentile nation. But there is such a thing as a foolish nation. Foolish in the eyes of Israel. Because they believed that somebody was their Messiah, who they thought was the most foolish thing in the world to believe. So he said, I will provoke you, Israel, to jealousy by them that are no people, and by a foolish nation. I will anger you. Let me ask you something. Was Paul angry? No. He was exceedingly mad against these people. Remember who Paul was mad against? Who? Say it. Yeah, I didn't hear you. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, thank you. Who was Paul mad against? The little flock. Listen, I'm not trying to put words in your mouth, okay? I want you to arrive at this conclusion because the Bible says it, not because I say it, and not because someone else said something different. Okay? Have no confidence in the flesh. Don't trust me. Don't trust anybody. Okay? I'm trying to help you understand this. Why is singular and not plural important in that word, nation? Why is that important? Anybody get an idea? Focuses on one. There's a biblical reason why this is important. Yeah. So we'll look at one of the parables of the Lord. I want us to learn something today. Matthew chapter 21. If you want to turn there, you can follow along. I'll put all the verses up here. Matthew 21:28. But what think ye? A certain man had two sons. And he came to the first and said, Son, go work today in my vineyard. He answered and said, I will not. But afterward, he repented and went. You know who this son represents? He represents the harlots and the prostitutes, as you're about to see in a couple of verses. You'll see, okay? And the publicans. Matthew 21:30. He came to the second son, likewise, and he answered and said, I go, sir, and went not. You know who he represents? Pharisees. The Pharisees. Oh, yeah, we'll do everything for you, God, and they did nothing. Verse 31, whether of them twain, did the will of his father? They say unto him, the first. Jesus saith unto him, verily I say unto you, the publicans and harlots go into the kingdom of God before you. See, the first one represented the publicans and harlots. See? He said, for John came unto you in the way of righteousness, and ye believed him not. But the publicans and the harlots believed him. And ye, Israel, when ye had seen it, repented not afterward, that ye might believe. Hear another parable. There was a certain householder which planted a vineyard. Okay, that's Israel. The vineyard is Israel. And hedged it round about. Now a hedge would be a wall of protection. A strong and mighty fortress is our God. Israel could say that. It could also represent the wall of partition, the middle wall of partition that separated Israel from the Gentiles. From the nations, plural, of the world. These people were an exclusive group of people that had been given everything by God, all of the advantages that nobody else in the world could claim and did not receive. They had everything. Notice it says, and he digged a wine press in it. Wine is made with grapes. God gave them every opportunity to bring forth good fruit unto him. And he built a tower. You know, the first time the word tower is found in your King James Bible is Genesis chapter 11, verse 14, at the Tower of Babel, when men tried to build a tower whose top may reach unto heaven. They tried to reach heaven. So God built a tower for Israel, a way for them to reach heaven through the tabernacle in the wilderness, through the Levitical offering system. Things that were designed by God to give man an opportunity to fellowship with him. God made a tower in there, representing their way of access to God. And led it out to husbandmen, that's the leaders of Israel. And went into a far country. He watched from a distance what they would do. And when the time of the fruit drew near, he sent his servants to the husbandmen that they might receive the fruits of it. The servants were the prophets. And the husbandmen, that's the Pharisees, took his servants and beat one and killed another and stoned another. Again, he sent other servants more than the first, and they did unto them likewise. But last of all, he sent unto them his son, saying, they will reverence my son. But when the husbandmen saw the son, they said among themselves, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him. Let us seize on his inheritance. And they caught him and cast him out of the vineyard and slew him. When the Lord, therefore, of the vineyard cometh, what will he do unto these husbandmen? Well, Romans 9, 10, and 11 answers this question, okay? That's what Romans 9, 10, and 11 is about. They say unto him, he will miserably destroy those wicked men and will let out his vineyard unto other husbandmen. Other husbandmen. Not other Gentiles. Other people. Which shall render him the fruits in their season. In other words, there are other people who will do what you did not do, Israel. They will believe and not be a faithless generation like you. They'll do what they're supposed to do. Jesus saith unto them, did you never read in the scriptures the stone which the builders rejected? Jesus Christ is the stone that they rejected. The same has become the head of the corner. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore say I unto you, the kingdom of God shall be taken from you and given to a nation, singular, bringing forth the fruit thereof. Notice nation, singular, not plural. This nation is made up of those who Jesus Christ called out of Israel. When he came to Israel and they didn't want him, he called who out? Those to whom he said, fear not, little flock. It is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Who? That other nation. Singular nation. Not the nations of the world. You know, just like today, you know, many people today look at organized religion. They see the corruption. They see the false doctrines. They see the confusion that is caused by trying to put people under the law, and they leave. Like many of you did. Like many of you online listening, you left what you were in because you saw what it was. You saw that it wasn't the truth. Then all of a sudden you hear the word of God rightly divided. And you go, what? You mean the Bible can be understood? You mean I don't have to be confused like this anymore? No, you don't. No, you don't have to be confused anymore. And then you come into the Word of God rightly divided, and you find out that there are people who actually know what's not written to them. And there are people who know what is written to them. And you want to join them because they unapologetically make those distinctions clear for you to understand the Word of God. And you feel like you've been saved all over again. Because finally there's a breath of fresh air. Right? Well, that's basically what happened in Israel's day. These people saw the religion. They saw the hypocrisy of the Pharisees. And when Jesus Christ came speaking truth, they flocked unto him and became the little flock. Speaking of religion, our friend Ann from Texas called me this week. Actually, she texted me first. She sent me the definition for the word religion. Wasn't planned to be in this message or anything. She just sent me a... Here's the definition for the word religion. I called her back afterwards and we laughed. But the word religion means, it's a noun, and it means to bind or to bind anew. Originally to have signified an oath or vow to the gods, or the obligation of such an oath or a vow, which was held very sacred by the Romans. Now, I thought that was very fascinating, because the first word in religion is to bind, or to bind anew. So the word bind means to tie together or confine with a cord, or anything that is flexible, to fasten as with a band, to confine or restrain, as with a chain, fetters, or cord, as to bind him hand and foot, to restrain in any manner, to oblige by a promise, vow, stipulation, covenant, law, duty, or any other moral tie to engage you in, to distress, to trouble, to confine by infirmity, whom Satan hath bound these 18 years, to constrain by a powerful influence or persuasion. That's the word bind. That's what religion means. So I received this text from her. I was going down the road. I slowed down. I got 100 feet before the car, behind the car ahead of me. But I started thinking of the word religion, because sometimes the etymology of a word is found within the word itself. You know, you can tell where a word comes from and the other words that it's linked to by some of the syllables that are in the word, right? So I said this over to myself, religion, 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 and all of a sudden this verse popped into my head. And it's the verse that's associated with when Jesus Christ went into the country of the Gadarenes. And there was a man possessed of a demon. And he was cast in the fire and out of the fire. And they tried to bind him, but they never could. Why? Because he was already bound by somebody else. He was bound by Satan. And Jesus Christ approached. Oh, by the way, it says that he dwelt among the tombs. He's a picture of Israel, possessed with devils and dwelling amongst the tombs. These are the walking caskets. Jesus called them whited sepulchres. Right? And Jesus Christ approached that man and he told the demon to come out. And the demon pleaded with Christ to not torment us. And the Lord Jesus Christ asked him, and he said to that, and he asked that demon, "What is thy name?" And he said, "My name is Legion, for we are many." And Jesus cast him out into a herd of swine. And the swine went and drowned themselves. Remember that story? After that demon was cast out of that man, the Bible says he was in his right mind. Right? Now listen to this. Had that man got possessed again, he would have been religioned. That's what religion is. They are religioned. To be religioned, it doesn't matter how tall the steeple is, how many stained glass windows there are, How holy the people look in their long robes and reverse collars. All the fanfare that goes with that. To be in religion is to be bound and fettered and serving the wrong master. So Ann and myself, we had a laugh. Not that it's funny that people are in religion and they're stuck in religion and they're bound in religion, but we figured out the etymology of the word religion. Israel was in religion. And that's why Jesus Christ said, the kingdom shall be taken from you and given to a nation, bringing forth the fruits thereof. The nation. The nation. In Matthew 21:43, is the foolish nation of Romans chapter 10, verse 19. The reason that I'm making this observation and these observations in this first message in our intro into Romans chapters 9, 10, and 11 is because the little flock are the major players in Romans 9, 10, and 11. And if you miss that, you miss everything. If you miss that, you miss the boat. And I'm sharing that with you because there are so many theories, so many ideas, so many interpretations of Romans 9, 10, and especially chapter 11, that it is out of this world. It's off the charts. I have brethren in Christ, preachers, and I know of four different views of Romans chapter 11. Four. I am not going to share those other views. I'm going to share what I see in here, period. Because my purpose in this is not to cast down this guy and cast down that guy. I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to present it the way it is. If it makes sense to you, then praise the Lord. If it doesn't make sense to you, then praise the Lord. Let every man be persuaded in his own mind, is the bottom line of chapters like this, because the people I'm talking about are great, great Bible teachers. You see? And so we're all seeing these different things. So you know what? You have to be persuaded in your own mind as to what it is. Now, I shared something with you today that I believe is so foundational in understanding this that I needed to put this first before we ever get in Romans 9, 10, and 11. So you'll know they're there. They're there. They're being talked about. And they're major players. And I'll tell you, there's some things. I mean, I read this every day. Romans 9, 10, I read every day, every day, every day, every day. All three chapters, every day. Sometimes twice a day. I'm starting to put things together. Wow! Pop, 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 pop. All these things are coming together. I'm like, wow. Whew. So, I'm not talking, you know, I'm not pulling and I'm not doing that. So, I really believe if you're going to understand these chapters, you have to know that these people are in the mind of the Apostle Paul. The major players are those people right there. So, I don't plan on taking very long to go through Romans 9, 10. It's not going to be 2-3 years, okay? Talking a couple of months maybe. And we'll go through Romans 9, 10, and 11. Then we can move on. And then after that, I want to go to the book of Ephesians. That's where I want to go next. So now that I know that I want to do that, I'm starting to get anxious for that. So, you know, I'm not going to shortcut the Word of God, that's for sure. But I'm going to try to present this to you in a very clear manner so you can see this is what it says, and I'm not going to try to twist it or make it say anything except what it says. argue with this, not with another man, not with me. You know what I'm saying? I think even in this room, some of you put too much confidence in the preacher when you should put more confidence in what the Word of God says. Search this out yourself. Study it. Study the Bible. Not what a man says. Study the Bible. That's your safest place to be. Okay? I'll give you guidelines as I did today. This is a very, very... This guideline today, this narrows a lot of things down. Removes a lot of things that could come in, because you don't want the things that coming in. You know what denominational brethren are guilty of? They're guilty. Let me go back. Let me tell you what they're guilty of. They're guilty of... Come on. Whoop, right there. They're guilty of living here in the dispensation of grace, reading this, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and thinking that what they learned here, that means that over here too. That's what they're guilty of. That's not rightly dividing the word of truth. Well, Romans 9, 10, and 11 are here. They're here. They have to do with this. They don't have to do with this. And there's the big mistake in Romans 9, 10, and 11 is thinking that you can take some of this and put it into that. That's not rightly, even Romans 9, 10, and 11 have to be rightly divided and keeping, if you stay in the context and you look, I know Paul said I speak to you Gentiles. We're going to explain that when we get there, what that means. In the context and in the historical narrative of when he says that in Romans 11:11, Romans 11:13, is right at the fall of Israel. That's a historical fact. When they fell, he became the apostle to the Gentiles. It doesn't say I'm talking to you like this is happening to you. He says that's what happened. It's not a big deal. It's not hard to understand that. But because that verse is there, a lot of people think that what he said after that, that he's talking about you. He didn't say, I'm talking about you. He said, I'm talking to you. And there's a whole world of difference in those two things. I'm not talking about you. I'm talking to you. It's different than what people think that means. So when we get there, that'll be interesting. But anyway, I just wanted to lay the foundation, basic, fundamental, before we start this today. Okay? All right. Amen. Lord, I thank you for this time that we could spend in the Word of God. I know that as we enter into a subject, the subject of Romans 9, 10, and 11, that the discrepancies and the differences that people have are glaring and obvious. And I just pray that the simplicity of the Word of God, as we have said so many times from this pulpit, nothing like a King James Bible to clear up a Bible college education. So Lord, I thank you this morning that we can open this book and just look at what it says and forget what anybody else says except you. I pray these things today. I pray that these words will be forged upon the tablets of our hearts. And I pray these things in that name that is above every name, the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.